You can probably tell by my skin color, but I'm a pretty big Hobson fan. I think his energy and aggression on his breakout project Raw really spoke to me as a kid, and he's done fairly well at changing with the times, even though he's hit a few creative snags down the road. I personally found Hobson after stumbling onto his track Sag My Pants in my recommended videos, and quickly fell down the rabbit hole and learned he had his own indie label called Funk Volume, which he started as a teenager, but he had only recently started to shape it into an actual legitimate business. He was able to slowly build the brand into a well-known name within the underground, and the internet in general by doing things like dropping a mixtape with label mate Swizz, and by doing a self-funded tour off his debut on the label, and hosting rap contests, which is actually where a lot of the community I've interacted with over the past decade mostly stem from. Very soon after I started following the label, Jaron Benton joined Hobson, Swizz, and Dizzy Wright, and this would be the Funk Volume roster we'd come to know over the next few years. With the addition of DJ Hoppa, who according to Wikipedia had been working with the label on and off since about 2011. It was actually pretty crazy to see the label rise as quickly as it did. They were moderately successful when I stumbled onto them, but they fucking blew up in the span of like 3 years. I remember watching Illmind 5 when it dropped at midnight and immediately getting like a million views, or Hobson collaborating with big names like Tech 9 and Dizzy doing stuff with Logic, or seeing the majority of them get XXL freshman spots, or their last tour being streamed live on fucking Yahoo of all places. It was clear the label was becoming a force to be reckoned with. Then right after was probably their biggest tour to date, and probably their biggest year as well. The entire label was rendered defunct after Hobson got into a dispute with co-owner Swizz's brother Dame Ritter. That was in 2015, and now at the turn of the decade, I'm feeling pretty nostalgic, so I want to go back and discuss just how everything fell apart, and maybe that will finally quiet the screaming voices in my head. The trouble really began at the end of 2014. Late that year, Dame finalized a contract with major label Warner Bros. To basically partner with Funk Volume as a distributor. A lot of fans and even the artists expected this deal to skyrocket the label. Dizzy even going as far to say he was expecting Hobson to start getting late night talk show appearances and everything, but the company's popularity level pretty much remained exactly the same. I remember going to FYE to buy Knock Madness when that came out, and I went to the same store to buy Pound Syndrome when that one came out, and only one of those had the Warner Bros. Machine behind it, so I definitely get how it was seen that Warner was bringing nothing to the table, cause I sure didn't notice the difference. Dizzy said that the entire label, including Dame, was frustrated with the Warner deal because it wasn't very fruitful, and Dame acknowledged he expected more from Warner as well, but he still didn't think the relationship was a waste of time.
I felt like Hobson kinda, didn't understand how Dame could let us get in this position. Dame was just kinda like, I didn't put you in this position. I thought the same shit you thought.
You know, the guys were definitely unhappy with the Warner deal. I felt it was a lot of it because they didn't really understand it. But I also could have expected more from Warner as well. So I was talking to him. I wasn't exactly happy with it either, but I was trying to fix it, and I was acknowledging the things that they were doing.
Which either way, it was kind of an L on Dame's part, in my opinion. Through all my research, the only thing I could say Warner legitimately did besides distribution was set up some radio tours for Dizzy to go on. Apparently, after all the confusion, Dame was able to set up a meeting between all of Funk Volume and some heads at Warner to discuss the deal more, and I guess this cleared up the situation for Jaron, and most likely Dizzy as well. But Hobson was mostly unsatisfied with the meeting. This is kind of the first horseman of Funk Volume's apocalypse rearing its ugly head. The next one was meet and greets that were taking place throughout the 2015 tour. The tour consisted of something like 52 dates, and to my knowledge, every single date on the tour also had a meet and greet, although they were limited to 75 tickets. Hobson claims that only he and Dame were getting paid for the meet and greets, but Dame argues that the meet and greets were being paid to the other artists, it was just that the money from the meet and greets would be paid to them at the same time as the money they'd receive from the regular shows.
So he tried to convince the Dizzy and Jaron that they weren't getting paid for meet and greets. Mm-hmm. So let me explain the meet and greet situation. So when I do the budgeting for a tour, right, we have the money that comes in from the shows, and we have money that comes in separately from meet and greets because we sell those separately on our website, okay. Right? When I do the budgeting, like for Jaron, I treat that income as the same. I could have easily said 800 is for the performance, mm-hmm. and 200 is for the meet and greet.
Right, gotcha. Right.
And that's what I should have done. So that's the error. So that's my error. Exactly.
I guess also at some point, Jaron approached Dame about how much he was getting paid for the tour because he felt it wasn't enough, and him and Dame were able to come to a conclusion. This is all speculation, but I assume it was due to him thinking he wasn't getting paid for the meet and greets, and Dame was able to explain the numbers to him and reach a mutual understanding, but honestly, that's just me giving Dame the benefit of the doubt. In general, Jaron and Dizzy just didn't seem as bothered by the meet and greets, but according to Jaren himself, he and Dizzy would get immensely shit-faced before them every time, and if you know anything about Hobson, you know he stayed far away from that shit. So the meet and greets were likely twice as miserable for him, especially when you consider the fact that fame and success had all but worn off for Hobson at this point, and the last thing he cared about was meet and greets. So much so that he apparently showed up super late to some of them. I guess at some point this all culminated in Hobson confronting the other artists on the label and telling them they should get new managers, and they agreed. So according to Hobson, he and Dame were 50-50 co-owners of Funk Volume, so Dame was receiving his cut from that, but he was also everyone's manager, which even if you're on Dame's side, you gotta admit is a pretty big red flag. According to Hobson, Dame was receiving 20% of all of Hobson's revenue for acting as his manager, and I assume it was the same for everyone else as well, which means Dame was raking in a whole lot of fucking money. Even as just Hobson's manager, he would have been very wealthy, but managing everyone on the label basically guarantees that man was balling uncontrollably. When asked in interviews about them agreeing to find new managers, both Jaren and Dizzy made it apparent it had nothing to do with Dame being incompetent in a managerial position. Jaren even went as far to say that the meeting wasn't even mostly about Dame, and that was just one of the things that they touched on. And as for Jaren's actual reasoning of wanting a new manager, he felt it was important to start building his own team of people under the Funk Volume umbrella, and more on that later. Jaren went on to say that Dame's position as his manager was always somewhat temporary, as Dame was acting as a replacement for Jaren's former managers, one of which who had recently passed on. He also said his main motivation was because he thought Dame managing all of them was a conflict of interest, which is very true. And I can't tell whether or not Dizzy was on board for replacing Dame as his manager or not, but he made it clear he was more frustrated with the label being stagnant than he was with Dame's abilities as a manager. Either way though, as a person who went to college for that type of shit, Dame had to have known that managing multiple artists under the same roof while also in charge of their revenue is completely unethical and would not fly in any other company, so that's definitely fucked up on his part. Soon after the meeting, Hobson contacted Dame since he wasn't on tour with them and informed him he wanted a new manager, and I guess Dame responded telling him something along the lines of, "How would a new manager help you? You don't even work hard," which sent Hobson into a blind fit of rage, and he immediately blocked Dame on everything. Now, I don't know if I have these events 100% correct, because it's hard to piece together from so many sources, but I think after that there was some type of business meeting, phone call with Dame, Hobson, and some other accountants or something like that in the company, where it was revealed that Dame was getting paid $50,000 just as the CEO for the FV 2015 tour, even though he wasn't even on the tour with them. Again, that's just as the CEO, that doesn't count for his revenue as a manager. When Hop asked him where he got those numbers, it somehow circled back into Dame telling Hobson he doesn't work hard again, and Hobson freaked the fuck out once more. Dizzy called Dame and went off on him and told him to stop telling the biggest artist on the label he doesn't work hard, but it turned out to be a wasted effort since not long after that, every artist on the label was on a big conference call, and Hobson started making a bunch of demands. He said he wanted to ditch the orange and black color scheme adopted by the label for so long, and that he wanted to start receiving a bigger cut and profit from his album sales. Dame responded telling him they're gonna have to talk about that more because upping his percentage would mean cutting into the label's budget since Hobson covers such a large portion of the sales. Hobson then told him, "Well, if my contributions are so important to the company, then maybe you shouldn't tell me I don't work hard." And Dame basically immediately responded with, "Well, you don't work hard, huh?" And Hobson immediately started yelling obscenities, hung up, and then went to social media to claim Dame destroyed his label and that Funk Volume was dead. It sounds to me like both of the people in charge of this company should not have been allowed to run a company. Hobson claims that the company folded due to Dame being a money-hungry backstabber, but the evidence just doesn't really show a whole lot of that. He obviously liked money very much, and I think he probably panicked when Hobson said he and the rest of the label wanted new managers because he was making so much money from that position. But the fact he was able to make the company something like $4 million in 4 years proves he knew what he was doing to some extent, and didn't just blow all that money at the poker table. The company then had to go through liquidation, which culminated in a legal dispute between Hobson and Dame, where Dame was trying to retain the rights to Hobson's old music. All the while, according to Hobson, he was slowly adding more and more to what was basically a diss track to Dame, which apparently Jaren felt a disturbance in the force and straight up told Hobson, "I don't know if you're making a diss track, but please don't." And fast forward a few months later, and Illmind 8 dropped to the masses, which had Hobson accusing Dame of basically stealing money from Funk Volume and spending it on gambling, and criticizing Dame's fitness subsidiary to the label, which Hobson seemed to not have a problem with when it was conceived, but now paints a picture like he was always annoyed by it. Illmind 8 also had Hop saying Dame was praying Dizzy Wright was gonna replace him, which I personally think there was kinda some truth to, especially near the final days of Funk Volume. Judging by Dizzy getting a radio tour off the Warner deal, I think they had a lot of stock in him as well, and I think this kind of intimidated Hobson, honestly. He had a bunch of lines even when Funk Volume was still around about how Dizzy's starting to blow up and it's probably going to start outselling him soon. Not to mention all the interviews after Illmind 8 dropped where Hobson just seems incredibly bitter.
I don't work hard though, right? His own brother Swizz doesn't even have one of these, let alone an album. Dizzy Wright, does Dizzy Wright have one of these? Does Jaren have one of these? But he treated me like I was the fucking scum of the label. He treated me like I just wasn't worth anything. He told me I don't work hard.
And Dizzy seemed to pick up on that energy long before Funk Volume was disbanded.
I've never even said this in an interview or anything, but I just don't think Hobson really rocked with me like that. I never had Hop call me and be like, yo, we should get in the studio. I've been in the studio. I've been with Funk Volume 4 years. I've been in the studio with Hop twice.
I think the thing that frustrates me the most about Illmind 8 is the fact that Hobson was a 50-50 co-owner with Dame. So if Dame was getting away with anything, it was damn near just as much Hobson's fault as it was Dame's. Hobson acted like he was all concerned because he thought the other artists weren't getting paid for the meet and greets and claimed Dame was a piece of shit for that, but according to the people he was defending, it was all figured out between them and Dame, so I guess he didn't care enough to look into it like they did. I guess he cared about their incomes enough to protest the meet and greets, but not enough to not put them out of a job. Instead of just taking Dame to court and finding a new CEO. Just listening to Hobson's music over the years and learning who he is as a person, and also the long-ass research I did for this video, I wouldn't be surprised to learn that he'd been wanting out of Funk Volume for a long time. Listening to Illmind 5, you would not assume that Jaren Benton and Dizzy Wright are signed to that guy's record label, and I think he had his issues with that, even though he was mostly cool with those guys.
Okay, from the outside, not even being biased towards me being Hobson, looking out from the outside in. Hobson just made this song, yo, but he has these rappers on the label, and that's all they talk about. They are what he dislikes in the song. That's 100% correct. I'm not saying they're bad rappers, but as far as the message, the reason and as far as the, now Dizzy, he has a mild good message, but it is very distorted by marijuana. It's almost so distorted to where you won't even notice that it's there, because when you see him, you almost just think of Wiz Khalifa, and you just see, just like Snoop Dogg. It's distorted.
Not to mention with the Fort Collins incident, all of Knock Madness, him walking off a revolt, and him no-showing press tours, it was apparent he was completely burnt out with fame at this point, and Dame was still this voice in his ear constantly telling him to get working because he was responsible not only for his livelihood, but everyone else's on the label as well. I think Hobson saw a very tiny window to hit two birds with one stone when the last You Don't Work Hard call happened, and he wedged his ass right into it. And while I think he handled it in the worst way he possibly could've, I still kinda get it. According to every person who's gotten famous ever, it's not that great on the other side, and judging by how Hobson was talking on Gazing at the Moonlight and Raw, I think he was assuming the other side was gonna blow his fucking mind. Instead, I think he found with more success came more responsibilities, and it fucked with his head a lot, and he made a very drastic decision, which I wouldn't mind so much if he didn't try to justify it with these straw man arguments. Both Jaren and Dizzy said on multiple occasions since the label shutdown that Dame was not the Suge Knight type. If Hobson really felt that Dame was stealing from his company, it wouldn't have taken much to, for lack of a better term, straighten him out.
Should've kept your word, Brian.
Also, Dizzy, who ended up staying with Dame and starting another label with him after Funk Volume broke up, straight up said if it was impossible to work it out and Dame absolutely had to go, then Dizzy would have stayed on Funk Volume regardless. And that's coming from Dizzy, who was almost always in Dame's corner. Any way you look at it, Hobson wasn't very justified in his decision to end the label out of nowhere. In my opinion, Dizzy said it best.
Dame told Hop he didn't work hard. That's why the label's over. It wasn't money problems. That wasn't a problem. He was mad.
And not saying that's the answer or anything. Kids don't take that as I'm fucking saying in order to have a good time and to get through shit, get high drunk. But it worked for me.
It's fun for you till I D-I-E.
A big reason why I made this video is to shed a little light on where everyone is now, because I honestly think, at least musically, they've all improved by leaps and bounds. Like Swizz, who I am just now discussing in depth because he wasn't really around for most of Funk Volume's success. He said he had some sort of personal issues that kept him from focusing on music, but he's been mostly pretty vague as to what those issues are exactly. But since Funk Volume's breakup, Swizz has really come into his own as an artist. He's got a lot more introspective and deep-cutting tracks now, and it's a really refreshing change of pace from the cartoony sidekick he was always always kind of portrayed as on the label. He also responded to Illmind 8 and the entire Funk Volume situation in general with his track Automatic, which basically had Swizz going in on Hobson on Dame's behalf, and he even put DJ Hoppa on it to do some scratches, which was pretty cold-blooded. All in all, I feel like Swizz made a lot of great points in Automatic. He basically says he saw the implosion of Funk Volume coming because Hobson was a very destructive, emotional person, and according to Dame, Swizz and Hobson weren't on the best of terms for a while anyway. So Hobson's original connection to the label was all but gone, and now he was just with Jaren and Dizzy, who he had only met a few years ago through the context of signing them to his label. Swizz also mentioned the Funk Volume situation again in Take Me Away, where he expressed that he had a lot of guilt for not being around when the collapse happened. He talks in the song about how he thinks he could have helped to prevent it, and while I don't think this was Swizz's fault by any means, if it didn't end when it did, it would have happened later, but I can't help but feel there's some truth to the idea that Swizz could have done something if he was there. Swizz was the one who brought Hobson to Dame in the first place, so I don't doubt that he would have been a good bridge between the two. Not to mention Swizz had been friends with Hobson since high school, so he would likely somewhat know how to handle him in one of his weird Hobson funks. Again though, it was only a matter of time before the company was gonna fall through. Hobson was very unhappy with his position in music and in life in general, and it was only gonna be so long before he pressed the self-destruct button on the whole operation. But as far as Swizz goes, he's actually been pretty consistent with drops for a while now, and all of the tracks have been really solid in my opinion. If you're one of those guys that wrote Swizz off because of either the beef with Hobson or the fact he never put out an album or anything, I urge you to give him another shot. He's basically got an album's worth of new material on his YouTube page now, but I still got my fingers crossed that an actual full-length project from him will drop sometime soon. I'll be honest, Dizzy is the one I kept up with the least after the breakup. I was a really dumb fucking backpacker kid that hated weed raps and anything that mentioned bitches or money, so I always dismissed him, but catching up on what he's been doing for this video proved to me I was kinda sleeping on him. But as far as Funk Volume goes, to my knowledge, Dizzy didn't bring it up much on Wax since the label ended, but don't take my word as gospel since he dropped 5 projects since Funk Volume went under and I wasn't about to comb through all them bitches for a Hobson jam. I will say this though, Dizzy definitely seemed the most hurt after Funk Volume ended. Jaren was already kinda reaching an understanding that a portion of Funk Volume's fanbase may not always fuck with him, so he was already preparing himself for a change of some kind. Dizzy though was fucking killing it. He was undoubtedly the most successful artist on the label besides Hobson, and he was only rising all the time. Apparently Dizzy and Logic were supposed to make a collab album, and the way Dizzy was talking, I think it was supposed to drop on Funk Volume, which would have been fucking huge for them.
Logic is definitely one of the best MCs out though, for sure.
Okay. Now, weren't you guys supposed to do a project together?
Yes.
What happened with that?
Life. I lost my label and, you know what I mean? The back end of my shit was dismantled, fucked up. And I had to do a lot of rekindling, you know what I mean?
So with that kind of success on the horizon, it would make sense that he would feel the difference of Funk Volume suddenly vanishing more than the others would. Early on, it was clear Dizzy held a bit of resentment towards Hop for everything, especially because at the time of the interview I watched, Hobson had yet to call or speak to Dizzy at all since the label folded. It was also probably because Hobson ruined Dizzy's chances at making a collab album with one of the biggest rappers in the world right now. But after Funk Volume had folded, Dizzy actually stuck with Dame, and they launched another record label together called Still Movin', and they had a decent little buzz going for a while there. They would put out these little cypher videos every week or something like that, and already had a pretty decent sized roster. But now, weirdly, I can't find a trace of the label existing, and it seems that Dizzy turned Still Movin' into some kind of clothing line or some shit, and turned the music half of the company into a rap group called 1 Week Notice. Dame said in an interview that all the artists on Still Movin' weren't under a contract, which is pretty confusing, but that also explains how it could just up and vanish so easily. I can't figure out why exactly it's not around anymore, but Dizzy was talking about some issues he'd been having with Dame in some interviews, and it seemed like their relationship as business partners was on a downward spiral. So maybe there's a little bit of truth to Dame not being the best businessman.
I'm still trying to figure out how to move forward with Dame in a comfortable way. You get what I'm saying? But the music industry fucked up some real friendships. And I know that that's important to Dame to remain friends at the end of the day instead of trying to force some business shit that may not work.
As far as what Dame is doing now, a while back he said on his LinkedIn that he was going to start managing Futuristic, but I have no idea if he's still doing that today or if he even ever started the position at all. As of right now, he's doing this weird music entrepreneur club thing, which I guess is helpful if you want to just get rid of money, but even then a paper shredder would probably do you better. I've never heard of a rapper getting famous off of these weird advice businesses, and I doubt I ever will. But back to Dizzy, I listened through some of his new album and his latest single that dropped while I was working on this video, and he's improved by a large margin. His flows are a lot tighter, and his lyrics interest me a lot more than his older stuff, plus he's got some kind of distribution deal with Empire going, and is pulling pretty consistently good numbers on all his music videos and whatnot, and I'm glad to see he bounce back for the most part. Like I said, I was never a big Dizzy fan when the label was around, but after working on this, I'm pretty eager to see where he goes from here. Like I mentioned before, Jaren was already at a place where he felt like he had to start separating himself from Funk Volume, so the breakup only made him lean into that more. Jaren seemed disappointed by the label going under, but at the same time, I think he was kind of relieved that all the backpacking, overanalyzing Hobson fans weren't a demographic he had to worry about anymore. One of Jaren's first singles after the fallout actually got a bunch of backlash from Hobson fans because it was, quote, too trappy. Even though literally most of Jaren's shit was trap when he was on Funk Volume. So yeah, he never said it outright really, but I can imagine he was frustrated having to deal with that all the time and was probably happy to start fresh. Although Jaren made it a point to say that he never wants to sign to another label because he doesn't want to give someone the power to pull the rug out from under his career again, which is perfectly understandable. And he stayed true to that with all of his releases since leaving Funk Volume up until his latest, which was actually dropped through Jay-Z's record label Roc Nation. But I have no idea if that was just a distribution deal or if his contract was just for one album, but I hope not. I was really glad to see he landed such a big deal, so hopefully they're keeping him around for a while. I honestly have the least to say about Jaren, but that's just because he's had his shit thoroughly together since Funk Volume ended. He kept a cool head when it folded, and since then he's been consistent with quality albums, and he's been doing this Bully Freestyle series where he flips rock songs into rap beats, and those are really good. Not to mention the Life is White series, which is a fucking treasure by itself, and his latest single, Wasabi, is really, really fucking good. While his stats aren't terrible by any means, they're not as good as Dizzy's or Hobson's, and that's a ginormous fucking shame. Jaren has proven himself to be very versatile, and almost everything he drops is really high quality. I fucking highly doubt this is gonna get more views than anything he's done, but if by chance you're watching this and you don't know Jaren or just haven't checked in on him in a while, I highly encourage you to go see what he's up to. That man is way too talented to be pulling less than 100k on a music video.
Man, you gotta say some senior citizen bullshit, man. Listen, nigga, if you wouldn't say fuck Dame, none of this shit never would be happening. It's fun for you
till I die. And now for the man who said fuck Dame. Hobson definitely had the biggest image change after the label ended. Starting with Illmind 8, he started leaning heavily into trap beats, which is something he only really dabbled in on his last album on Funk Volume, Pound Syndrome. He also went on a big fuck Dame press run where he tried to explain himself, but he didn't do a very good job of it in my opinion. If there were money problems in Funk Volume, they were very minimal and could have been worked out easily, and his only excuse besides that was that Dame told him he doesn't work hard. I personally wish he was just honest and said he was in a declining state of mind and made a very irrational decision because of it, but honestly, I don't think he was being honest with himself about that yet, let alone with us. Hobson was basically talking in all these interviews like he had no control over how the company was ran, but that's just factually not the case. He was a co-owner. If there was anything shady happening under his roof and he didn't like it, he had the legal right to do something about it at any given time, but instead he just nuked the whole operation and then blamed it all on Dame. Apparently Hobson offered Jaren and Dizzy deals with his new label Undercover Prodigy, but they turned him down, and Hobson said it was because they wanted to do their own thing, but I would assume they just didn't want to work with Hobson as their boss anymore because he shut down their place of employment for a really fucking silly reason. His early singles after Illmind 8 were not very good at all in my opinion. After both Bout the Business and False Advertisement dropped, I actually unsubscribed from his YouTube for a while and completely wrote him off for a few months until he won me back with a free verse track he dropped called Bust That. After that, his album No Shame dropped to somewhat mixed reactions, but if you ask me, it's definitely his best album. I can't tell his beats were made in FL Studio right off the bat anymore. The mixing is a lot richer, I feel like, and that man completely stepped up his rapping abilities as well. My only real issue with it is all the stuff about his girlfriend and his maybe it's mine, maybe it's not kid. Basically, every time those topics get brought up, he handles it really poorly and distastefully and comes off looking like the bad guy, even though he doesn't think he does. He also responded to Swizz's automatic track track on All Your Fault, which was an alright song, but the diss was pretty weak. And like a month after it came out, Hobson was saying in interviews he wishes he was cool with Swizz and the rest of Funk Volume, so I don't know if he regretted it that quickly, or if that interview was done before the track, or what. But since then, he's basically just dropped singles, some of the highlights being Picasso and Hell's Carol. And then there's shit like The Old Us, which is him pleading with his baby's mama to stop playing games and go back to the old her and forgive him, even though he just made an album not long ago that was all about how much he hated her and her parents. I really think Hobson has zero self-awareness sometimes. And then we get to his latest track called I Don't Want It, which is basically Hobson just explaining that he's completely exhausted with fame and is still on a pretty bad mental decline. He also refers to Funk Volume breaking up in the song and says something like, whose fault was it? Ain't hard to say, which I can't tell if that's him taking responsibility for the situation or if that's just one more jab at Dame for the hell of it. Either way, the song is legitimately great and shows to me he has some sort of regret for how he handled the situation at least. Listening to this track and watching a somewhat recent interview on No Jumper really showed to me Hop's in a really tough spot right now. He doesn't really have any friends to enjoy his fame and fortune with because he pushed them away, and he can't really make new friends because they're gonna be out for fame and fortune. I definitely feel like Hobson is a very emotional person and can come off like a huge jackass a lot of the time, but I try to remember it's due to how fucked up he is mentally. Not to say he should get a free pass or anything, but I think it's important to understand that Funk Volume was probably a giant weight on his shoulders because he was responsible for everyone else on the label as well. The fact he launched Undercover Prodigy as soon as Funk Volume ended and has yet to sign anyone is pretty telling. I think Hobson just wasn't prepared for handling his fame, let alone anyone else's, and like I said before, he saw a small window to get out and wedged himself through it, but I think he's finally starting to figure out it didn't fix much. I really get the sense that Funk Volume was more Dame's label than it was Hobson's. Which I know doesn't make sense in hindsight because Funk Volume was Hobson's creation, but Dame said in an interview, his goal with Funk Volume was to eventually have an artist for each subgenre of rap, so if you're a person who likes rap music, you're bound to like someone on Funk Volume. Which admittedly is pretty smart from a business perspective.
Because I wanted Funk Volume to be that label where no matter, if you say you like hip hop, by the time we got 10 artists, there's gotta be somebody on this label like, that yeah, you rock yeah. with.
However, when asked about Undercover Prodigy, Hobson said he doesn't want a bunch of different subgenres and that he wants everyone on the label to be someone that a Hobson fan could enjoy.
I don't ever like the idea of like signing artists who are just gonna be one of those artists where you're like, yeah, I fuck with Hobson, but I don't, that other guy, I don't really care. Yeah. Like, I don't like those type of labels.
And this just goes to show how not on the same page Hobson and Dame were, and that's why Funk Volume was always gonna fail no matter what. Also, Dame wasn't very good at explaining things to people, and Hobson wasn't very good at listening, so it made for a pretty volatile reaction. It just irks me that Hobson was trying to act like he was an innocent bystander that got fucked over when this was literally his company. I mean, obviously just shutting down the label and starting a new was probably the easiest option, but if he cared as much as he said he did, I really feel like he could have done something. Not to say Dame is innocent though by any means. While I don't think he was stealing from the company or anything overtly illegal or too fucked up, I for sure think he really liked money and was gonna do what he could to make a lot of it and hold on to it. In the Funk Volume documentary, there's a clip of Dame on the phone with somebody talking about Knock Madness being delayed and that Hobson is still working on it, and his tone of voice just sounds kind of annoyed. Plus in interviews, he said some backhanded shit like mentioning Hobson would miss flights and then say he thinks he did it on purpose. It kind of sounds to me like Dame was building up just as much resentment for Hobson as Hobson was for Dame. Also, Dame was trying to keep Hobson's masters after Funk Volume ended, and that was a whole legal dispute by itself that luckily Hobson came out on top of. That was a pretty dumb fucking move by Dame though, just cause it made him look pretty money hungry, and that's the last impression he should have been making. Ultimately though, I mainly feel bad for Dizzy, Jaren, and Swizz. They had no control over this shit. They hit the so-called big time and then it was immediately swept away and they had to rebuild by themselves. And the saddest part is, I don't think Funk Volume was anywhere near its peak. Dizzy was starting to work with Logic, Dame was brushing up with people like Russ, who would go on to be huge, and currently Hobson with his trap raps is pulling like 5 million views minimum on every new music video. It just makes you wonder if everyone was still where they're at creatively, but were also still a unit and a team, where would their careers be right now? It's very possible they'd be bigger than they ever were or ever might be. Dizzy said he thinks Hobson used the Dame beef to launch the next stage in his career, and whether Hobson admits to that or not, I think it's kinda true.
I just never expected him to take an issue and, you know, from his family, like the Funk Volume family, and use that to try to benefit his career.
It's super fucking corny to end the video like this, let alone even mention the quote at all, but it really just reminds me of that Facebook quote your aunt shares that has minions on it for some reason. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Hobson decided he wanted to go fast instead of far, and I think he's kind of paying the price for it now. I'll always be grateful for Funk Volume just because of how important it was to me as a kid, and because of the community it introduced me to and allowed me to find friends at a time I otherwise wasn't able to. But I'll always have that question in the back of my head. Where would they all be if Funk Volume never ended?